How many did some homework this week? Did you go over, did you get your questions out and determine that the first 100 days this year is going to set the tone for this year? You know, the first 100 days, they matter a lot. And when we look at, like, our 2016, what was our phrase last week? We look backward to bring closure to last year, right? We look backward to be, what do we expect to happen in 2016? What actually happened? How many know we need to learn from expectations to reality? Because if we don't close it up, that's where regret and guilt and all that ugly stuff comes from, right? So we look backward to bring closure. What do we look forward for? To build momentum. We look forward to build momentum. What do we want? Not just what we want, but what we really want. Because if we want to be in shape in January, but we want cookies in July, then we really don't want to be in shape in January, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, so not just what do we want, but what do we really want, right? And then why do we want it, the motivator, and then what needs to change to go get it, right? And then how are we going to get it? That builds momentum. So we look backward to bring closure. We look forward to bring momentum. And then what was the third one? We look upward to what? To bring meaning. We look upward to bring meaning, because when we put everything in Christ in our life, everything in our life has meaning. All of a sudden, the goals have meaning when we're looking upward. All of a sudden, the physical goals have meaning when we're looking upward, because we're going to do God. We're going to be your hands. We're going to be your feet the rest of our days, God. So we look backward to close up the past of what we expected to happen but maybe didn't, right? We close that up, because if we don't close it up, what happens? It dogs the momentum, doesn't it? Because you keep thinking about where you failed. Like, you got to close the past, look backward for closure, look forward for momentum, look upward for meaning. All of a sudden, the business has meaning. It's not just money. The money has meaning in the business when we're looking upward and we're realizing that God wants to do something with us. As long as our eyes stay fixed on Him, every part of our life begins to have meaning in a new way. Amen? And so as we go into setting the tone in this series, and we set the tone for the first 100 days, I want you to know, like, as a church, we have some big momentum that's building in the first 100 days. And the big momentum, it just builds week to week to week to week. And this week, we're launching something that we want to get everybody on board here with. And that is, we're launching something coming together as a community. And for 21 days, we are going to focus our soul attention on the Lord. And we're going to have almost spiritual renewal, if you will, for the beginning of a brand new year. Because how many know that what's going on in your heart and what's going on in your spirit is affecting everything that happens in your flesh? I'm telling you, some of the stuff that you want to work in the natural, business-wise, relation-wise, socially, emotionally, some of the changes that you want to make in yourself, they're unmakeable, they're uncorrectable, because spiritually, you haven't taken the time to just stop and say, God, what is your will for all these things? Perhaps God's will for your business is over here, and you're focusing over here. Maybe He wants you to own the building, and you're busy just hoping you can make the payment. You see, like until we stop the train for a second and say, God, what do you want for me in all these areas of my life? And that's where prayer and fasting come in. I can think of several major seasons in my own life where fasting was a huge part of either a decision that I was going to make or a step I was going to take. And I think probably the first time that I really implemented this with any seriousness, it was right after that moment where I saw Melinda in a new light. We had been friends for a long time. A long time. I met Melinda. I was in the ninth grade when I met Melinda. She was a seventh grader. We were friends. We hung out in youth ministry. We went on mission trips together. We went to, you know, concerts together. We had friends together. We hung out at each other's house. But for some reason, in the spring of 1989, she just was not the same girl that I'd hung out with all those years. I'd come home for a weekend getaway just to come be with Mom and Dad, and I went to church, and I saw her at church, and I'm like, my gosh, who is that? I leaned over to my buddy Nate, Matt Lacoste's brother, Nate Lacoste, and I said, who is that girl on stage? Because she was on stage doing something at church, and he says, that's Melinda. And I'm like, no, it's not. Shut up. And I just knew that I knew that God And so that was a Sunday. On Monday, I fasted. I did a juice-only fast for 5 days to purify my life. Because I'm telling you, when you're getting ready to pick the one, you, A, don't want to be wrong when you're ready to make that move. Right? Hey, you know, God told me you're the one. Sorry, he told me something else. That would be the worst. That would be the worst day of my life, right? Like, So I did. I went on a 5-day journey to purify my life. Not only that, I wasn't really living very pure. And I felt like if this is going to be the relationship to be of all relationships, then I better get my heart right. Just think about that. If this is going to be the year of all years, this is going to be the year where things happen in your own life, you better have your heart right going into it, because I'm telling you, you might think it's right, but I'm telling you, if you'll just make the investment and just consecrate yourself before God and just begin to seek him. I can think of another time I fasted. It was on the threshold of a big project in our church. My dad had come to me, and I literally was a part of the team for about 6 months officially. And my dad asked me to champion the fundraising to buy a facility for the church over on 1405 West Main Street. And he asked me to raise the money. I'm like, isn't that your job? Right? And so I felt very scared because I had never raised a dollar in my life. And I felt like, you know, one of the most misinterpreted things is the whole equation of how money and the church and all that stuff. And so I fasted. And I fasted to make sure that my heart was in the right spot. God, what is your will for this house? What can my expectations be? You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So big decisions in your life, but also big projects in your life. It's worth fasting. In 2001, I did a 21-day fast. Or I might have done a 40-day fast in 2001. It had been almost a year since my parents had died. And I was dealing with great grief. Not grief that everybody could see, but only the grief that I could see. And so I said, God, I need help with my grief. See, a lot of people think that fasting is just about getting things from God. Sometimes it's just about being with him. I just needed to be with him at that time. I just needed to realize that he's bigger than this grief. And I didn't expect to come out of the end of the 21 days of fasting, or the 40, whatever it was, and be like, oh, I'm all better. I didn't expect that. But what I expected is that over this consecrated time that I choose, God, to create my appetite for you, I just expect to be with you. Help my grief. There's another time I fasted because I needed healing, just some emotional healing. And I just, once again, I just needed to bring those things to God. Guys, fasting is very, very, very powerful. Yeah. It's powerful in your life, and it's powerful in my life. And I don't know what you're believing for this year. I don't know if it's something in maritally, or it's vocationally, or it's maybe it's something relationally. Maybe it's something emotionally that you're battling. Maybe it's something that you're believing for financially. Maybe it's just time for the heaviness and the curse of poverty be removed from your family and removed from your life. You don't talk about this stuff with your friends. I mean, this is not stuff that you discuss at dinner table. You don't post this kind of, I'm talking about stuff you don't post on Facebook. I'm talking about the deep-seated things that only God knows that you feel hindered and limited and tripped up by. And God is calling you, like in Psalm 42, he's calling you to a greater depth with him. And I'm telling you, Jesus laid something out for us in this amazing thing called fasting and prayer and consecrating time, where we can truly begin to deal with those things, those secrets that are hidden in our heart, those secret things that we're going through that we don't talk to a lot of people about, maybe a confidant or two knows. But other than that, man, these are the things that we don't show anybody, but we can show them to God, and we can give them to God, and we can literally see breakthrough in some of the most embattled and largest fortresses of our mind and our heart and our spirit. Those walls can come crumbling down in the atmosphere of fasting. Fasting's been a part of my life at every major breakthrough in my life. I've never had a breakthrough without it. I've had to make a decision to say, God, this season, this distance right here, is all about you. And I just believe with all my heart, I believe that the first 100 days, it sets the tone. Matthew chapter 6, Jesus is talking to you and I. He's talking to his team, and he's talking to us about some protocols. One of his protocols in verse 2 is he says, when you give, don't make a big deal about it. You know, don't let the left hand know what the right hand's doing. Just kind of give without, basically the theme of the chapter is the world is not your stage. And I know that's a little countercultural today, because today we want to be famous more than fulfilled. And so I know it's a little cultural, but Jesus is addressing something that I think actually fits in our culture so perfect right now. He's like, the world's not your stage. When you give, you know, you just don't need to make a big deal about it like some do. Then he says this. He says, when you pray, don't use all them fancy words and try to impress people with your language and your vocabulary and your smarts and your intellect, right? He's like, what does he teach us in Matthew 6 about prayer? He teaches us what? Teaches us the Lord's Prayer, doesn't he? When you pray, pray like this. So he's like, when you give, do it this way. And when you pray, do it this way. What's very interesting in verse 16 in Matthew 6, he says, and when you fast, do it this way. And I always find it very interesting because I pay a lot of attention to little wisdom nuggets in the Bible. And there's that one in Ecclesiastes that says, a three-stranded cord cannot be broken. And I see the discipline and I see the experience in a lot of believers' lives today where they truly do spend what it takes. They do what it takes to give and they do what it takes to pray. But nobody really wants to talk about verse 16 and when you fast. And yet I just am wise enough to believe the Bible for what it says and take it at face value is that this three-stranded cord is not easily broken. And perhaps there is a fair amount of strength actually within the weakness of fasting. And there's a fair amount of insight and discovery and breakthrough for our life when we choose to add fasting to the schedule, if you will, or to our time. See, fasting gives you victory with God where you've only known defeat by yourself. I'll say that again. Fasting gives you victory with God where you've only known defeat by yourself. It gives you victory. This is what Jesus says in verse 18. And I use the Message because it's so like right in my own face. This may not speak to you, but it speaks to me. When you practice some appetite denying discipline to better concentrate on God. So that's the Message version of when you fast. When you practice some appetite-denying discipline to better concentrate on God. He says, don't make a production out of it. It might turn you into a small-time celebrity, but it won't make you a saint. If you go into training inwardly, act normal outwardly. Note to self, shampoo and comb your hair. Brush your teeth. Wash your face. God doesn't require attention-getting devices. He won't overlook what you are doing. He'll reward you well. Fasting is going into training inwardly. Fasting is concentrating on God intentionally. It's going into training. It's taking a step. One of the things it's not, fasting is not going without food. It's not starving. It's not dieting. It's not reserved for religious monks in a monastery. It's not observed only on special days of the year. Fasting is not just reserved for, you know, religious officials or special people. Fasting is for anyone who wants to go train the inner man, the inner self, and concentrate for a season of time on God. And if the first 100 days sets the tone for the next 265, then how might the next 21 days set the tone for the entire year? Because this is what my prayer has been for you as I've been praying for you this year, is that this year not just be a great year, but it be a game-changing year, a transforming year for every year thereafter. Because there are years like that, and for me it's a year of expectancy for the families of this house, for this house. And so fasting becomes this focus, this concentrate. What fasting is it is going without food for a period of time in order to concentrate on God. It is a blessed way to start a new venture. If you're starting a new venture, it's a blessed way to start that with fasting. Maybe it's a business. Maybe it's you're getting married soon. Maybe it's a new relationship. Fasting is a great way to step out and say, man, I realize that Jesus is the Lord of my life. Fasting is powerful for somebody that just gives their life to Christ. Fasting's incredible for somebody that desires that, hey, I have been living just kind of chaotically, and I'm going to live in purity for God. Fasting is huge for that. It has been practiced as a viable way to connect with God at a powerful level since the beginning of man's relationship with God. It's the secret breakthrough for the hunger of God. Matthew 5:6, Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled." I'm telling you, a lot of times, the breakdown in some of the things that we desire in our lives, our potential, the breakdown is not that God doesn't want to do it. It's not that we're incapable of doing it. It's that we don't hunger and thirst for righteousness and justice of God in the way that He has called us to. See, something you really have to know that fasting, it's not about worthiness. It's not about becoming worthy for God to do something in your life. Your salvation in Jesus Christ already has sealed the deal that makes you worthy for God to move in your life. Fasting doesn't advance your position in Christ at all. A lot of people think, well, man, you must fast because fasting makes you more Christ-like. And I would say it along this way. That's true because Jesus set an example of fasting and we're to become like Christ. But it doesn't improve our position in God. Fasting doesn't move us up the needle or change our position from third chair in the band to first chair in the band. We are already first chair in the band because of Jesus. And so fasting doesn't earn us any blessing. It doesn't earn us any favor. Fasting didn't earn me purity. Fasting didn't give me healing. Fasting doesn't give you the wife you always wanted or the husband. Listen, those things are already orchestrated and promised of God before you lifted a finger to not pick up a fork and feed your belly. Fasting, it's not about worthiness. It's about focus. It's about discipline, guys. And I know we don't like to really talk about discipline a lot because we think about discipline as like a negative connotation, but do you realize that the word disciple, it comes from discipline. Being a disciple of Jesus is disciplining in ourselves to serve him, to grow with him, to build with him. So while disciplining ourselves doesn't improve our stature with him, we're already at the table. What it does do is it improves our focus on him. And that's what I mean, is all of a sudden our potential in Christ becomes much more clear and radiant and relevant and powerful when we focus and concentrate on God. It changes us. It really changes us. I put something together for you because I'm asking everybody in this room, I'm asking you to fast with us for the next 21 days. I'm asking you to do it for you, but I'm also asking you to do it for this house. Do something. Well, what do you want? Well, there's all different ways to fast. I mean, there's all different ways. We're doing a 21-day fast. I'm doing a pastor's fast. You know what a pastor's fast is? It's liquids only all day, and it's one meal at night. Because I have to function. And so maybe you're here, and you're like, hey, I like that, because I want to function too. But don't kid yourself. With as much as I eat in a 24-hour period, there's still going to be some suffering involved. Right? I am one fast away from my weight goal. You know what I'm saying? Or you can do a Daniel fast. A Daniel fast is vegetables only. I wouldn't recommend you do a water-only fast. Now, some of you are going to say, well, that's like the only way to fast because that's the way Jesus fasted. And then go talk to your doctor about that because those are tough. I've done a few of those. Those are tough. Never done a 21-day, but I did a 7-day. That's tough. But the purpose of it, guys, is not to improve our stature. It's to focus on him so he can speak to us, about our potential. So I had the ushers prepare something, and we're going to hand it out right now to you. We're going to do a little exercise right here at the end of the service. Here, give me one because I don't have one up here. You're going to be getting two things. You're going to get a blank envelope. There's a pen in the chair in front of you. So get a pen. Get a pen in your hand. So here's this little form, and when you get it, it basically just says the Rock Church 21 days of prayer and fasting, spiritual renewal, daily devotion, prayer, start 2017 right. And the left column is a whole bunch of reasons why to fast. Why am I fasting? Passion, prayer, finances, vision, ownership of the word, finishing. Maybe you're a person that starts a lot and doesn't finish. You're going to fast to break that thing. Willingness to serve, a hunger for God, salvation of others, influence, your church, your ministry, spiritual maturity, your business, marriage, children, healing, perseverance, purity of heart. Couple blank spots down there for what is the Lord stirring in you. So I want you to just take your pen and like put a checkbox on these are the things that I'm going to fast for over the next few days, a few weeks. I'm going to focus on God and I'm going to expect him to speak to me in these areas. Now I realize for some of you, this is going to take a little bit of a faith journey for you. You're feeling a little bit right now, oh my gosh, Pastor Jeff's handing out tests and stuff. This feels like school. No, I'm not testing you in anything. I'm exhorting you to begin this year, your first 100 days, with a focus over 21 days, a concentration on God to speak to you about these things. Now, Another thing that fasting does is fasting breaks the bondages of sin. Jesus fasted 40 days, and what was broken off of him? Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Real live things that could have ripped off his ministry, that 40-day fast right at the beginning crippled those bondages in his life. So in the right column, where do I need breakthrough? Overcoming addiction, beating complacency, breaking poverty. Remember the things I was talking about? We don't talk about stuff like that. Familiarity, disrespect, pride, idleness, gossip, quitting, doubt and unbelief, gluttony, laziness, bitterness, idolatry, immorality, a negative attitude, sexual indiscretions, priorities and focus. Psalm 19 talks about errors and secret faults and presumptuous sin and the great transgression. What do I need breakthrough in? Now give your neighbor give them the privacy to fill this out candidly and honestly, because we're going on this journey together, and every day for 21 days, we're going to be praying for you, we're going to be fasting for you, we're going to be focusing on God for your breakthrough, and at the end of this month, we're going to have a tone set.